Before starting the session, please turn off your mobile phone or switch it to silent mode. 시작하기에 앞서 휴대폰을 꺼주시거나 무음 모드로 바꿔주시기 바랍니다. For plenary session, simultaneous interpretation will be provided. Please turn into channel 1 for Korean and 2 for English. Thank you very much. 본 세션에는 한영 동시 통역이 지원됩니다. 영안 통역은 채널 1번, 한영 통역은 채널 2번으로 맞춰주시기 바랍니다. 감사합니다. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll begin the plenary session 2. I'm today's MC, Jihae Lee, in Chungnam National University. 지금부터 플래너리 2세션을 시작하도록 하겠습니다. 저는 오늘 사회를 맡은 충남대학교의 이지혜입니다.
We'll have one keynote speech and 5 panel speeches. After finishing all speeches, we'll have the discussion and Q&A time.
한 명의 기조 연설. 다섯 명의 패널 연설이 끝난 후 토론 및 질의응답 시간을 가질 예정입니다.
And I'd like to present you the moderator of this session, Dr. Kyung-sun Song, the representative expert of Korea Export Consulting Group.
본 세션의 좌장으로 한국 전문가 컨설팅 그룹 대표 전문위원 송경순 박사님께서 맡으셨습니다.
Dr. Song has been actively involved in various consulting projects in national and international level as an advisory board in numerous committees.
송경순 박사님께서는 수많은 위원회 고문으로 활동하며 다양한 컨설팅 프로젝트에 참여하고 계십니다.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome him with a big round of applause.
송경순 박사님을 박수로 맞이해 주시기 바랍니다.
Yeah, thanks for the introduction. In fact, I almost missed this session because I missed my train this morning, so I had to rebook and I was able to come in time. First of all, welcome to this important session on SMEs. In recent years, as you may know, the SMEs, importance of SMEs as a driver of economic development is revisited and refocused and re-emphasized. Since the 1980s, the globalization has changed the economic profile and global also industrial landscape, and giving more power to bigger corporations, like multinational corporations have become bigger, and the leading companies have become bigger and stronger, whereas the second-tier companies were downhill or disappeared. Domestically, also, small and medium-sized companies got squeezed by the international and multinational corporations and bigger corporations, and many have disappeared. But in recent years, the importance of SMEs is refocused. And in recent years, as you know, the United Nations also give a special also mention to the importance of technology and the role of SMEs. So today, we're going to revisit also this topic, listening to the distinguished and high-powered speakers today. And promoting the development of SMEs is not an easy task. It's actually a very difficult and daunting task. how to foster the new ventures, even when the new technologies and new innovations are discovered. And there is also a task of like bringing the new task into a substantive business. The commercialization issue, how to promote it, whether we have an ecosystem to promote it. For small and medium-sized enterprises, also they have to cope with the big challenges and how to maintain the momentum for growth, how to, because they're always squeezed, they're always challenged, unless they just belong to the supply chain dominated by bigger corporations, many SMEs cannot survive. It's a matter of survival maximization. The question now is, what are the roles of stakeholders in the ecosystem? What is the role of the government? And sometimes government over-intervenes in the system to the extent that they create a Peter Pan, the psychology. They, small and medium companies do not want to grow because once they grow up, they don't enjoy the same level of support from the government. Bigger companies also have to play a role as the originator or maybe the foundation of the supply system, supply chain. And the, finally, how we will just establish the most constructive, effective interface between the public and private sector to promote also SMEs, especially through the support for innovations and technology development. On this important topic, we have many distinguished guests, distinguished speakers. And keynote speaker is Raimund Broechler. Is pronounced is correct? I studied German in high school, Hochschule. He's an expert, he's a guru in technology, PPP. He got involved in both public and private sector activities. So he will just give the over glimpse of this important topic for 25 minutes. Raimund, the floor is yours.
So good morning, everyone, and welcome back to all those I saw already the years before. As I always promised, I would like to introduce something new to you, and I will also have a repetition of what I discussed last year with some updates this afternoon in the KAIST session. What I'm talking about today is about something you would say, not so new. It's about public-private partnerships. And I will also explain my role and why I dare to judge on these programs, because I'm paid and I'm working for a private organization. We are an industry partner, and we are using the programs that are given by the governments. And we have quite a good understanding of those instruments, if they work or not. So today I want to give you an overview why I think some of these PPPs and the revised approach of the European Commission works very well and what exactly the way is they're doing it. The structure of my talk is the following. First of all, I would just like to give you a small understanding about my different roles and what I'm doing. So I will give a short intro about Intrasoft International. Then I'm also the vice president of the International Network for SMEs. Yeah, so we are running in this association services that are supporting SMEs and also judge, evaluate, and make impact assessment of programs, and we are in dialogue with the policymakers in order to make suggestions worldwide. And then I will come to the actual topic, which is public-private partnership, PPPs, and I will give two very important implementation case studies. And I think we hopefully all agree that they are key for all economies all over the world. It's manufacturing, what I would call a sleeping beauty, because manufacturing has often not touched the right way. And policymakers have not really taken care for manufacturing and started to massively outsource and therefore lost any connection to innovation, especially on the connection if we talk about Industry 4.0 or smart manufacturing. And the future internet is another approach which seems to be very successful on a new way to handle the internet and to have independent, open European system that can compete with the existing infrastructure. Okay, so what is Intrasoft International? We are an IT company and we're doing IT solutions and services. And we are not so old. We started 1996 in Luxembourg and we are now located in 17 countries. Our main client, you see it here, is IT solutions to governments. So we are running a lot of those policy instruments where we develop the IT. For example, CORDIS, which is the research database, the participant portal is also a development. We developed the technology transfer systems for the European Commission and so on and so on. But we work, of course, also with enterprises and we work with the big organizations like Oracle, SAP, Software AG and so on, where we mainly act as system integrator. So we are a key player in EU institutions and agencies from now more than 15 years. This is just a glimpse of where we are based. Headquarters, as I said, is Luxembourg, but we are also quite present in Brussels, of course, and in Athens, because we are a member of the holding of Intracom, which is a telecommunication company. And if it comes to the employees, we are 1,500 professionals within the company. With this distribution of personnel, we're to have 20 nationalities and highly skilled people and always on the spot, fast doing the developments with our educated people in the company. And okay, now my other hat, which is being vice president of INSME. Just a short introduction what INSME is doing. It's an international network for small medium enterprises and it's a private not-for-profit association and exists since 2004 and is open to international membership. We are very comparable with WTA and we have a very, very close collaboration with WTA since many years because we think that the strong associations should work together and collaborate and exchange. We have a bit different locations. We have main base in Europe, whereas WTA is covering also worldwide organizations, but has a big presence in Asia. So we agreed on collaborating together on a lot of topics. The memberships, we have 82 members, and this could be ministries, organizations that support SMEs, other associations, 16 OECD and 20 non-OECD members. And it's all about the support to SMEs and which instruments are those ones that help SMEs to survive in the global market. And then we have, of course, different services, but you can check all that in the web. now public-private partnerships. The topic seems to be, well, we know that, yeah? But what the Commission did within the last research framework program, which was the FP7, was a very good analyze of public-private partnerships and where they are good and where they are bad and what has to be improved. And main focus was on exploitation. So whenever we do research, we should, in a public-private partnership, do the research within the first third of the project. And then afterwards, move to innovation and exploitation. So what is new in this program? The President of the European Commission, Mr. Juncker, has on his agenda several topics, and most of those should be familiar to all the other countries. They're quite comparable. It's a new boost for job growth and investment. You know the situation that we have because of the crisis in many countries, Greece, Spain, Portugal, and so on. High unemployment rates, and this has to be tackled. And we have also to analyze where, in which sectors, we made mistakes, and where is support needed. And so there are targets like the digital single market, which is still a problem within Europe. If you just think about the VAT for IT services, it's a disaster. And then, of course, stronger global actors. And within these 10 topics by the PPPs, 5 priorities are directly tackled. And whenever I'm talking about PPP, it's public-private partnership. And CPPPs, this is contractual PPPs. And it will just give a short understanding of what the difference is. So why did the Commission continue this approach of public-private partnerships? It is not the whole Horizon 2020 program is a public-private partnership. It's just a part of the budget. These projects are supposed to be highly innovative, and they are touching the key sectors where the European Commission, where Europe and the member states want to have an impact. So what were the problems and what has to be tackled? The R&D investments are essential for growth and high quality job. This means whenever the Commission is giving support, they have to attract people and come up with attractive programs. Yeah. Problem still compared worldwide is the EU business underinvests in R&D compared to other countries, and so on. You know most of these topics. One important one is here, and to facilitate prioritization of research and innovation in line with Europe 2020 objectives and industry needs. So instead of having this principle that you spread the water around in the garden and everyone gets something, it's a much more focused and specialization approach in specific industrial areas where we need to improve. And this was the situation within the former research program. Which areas have been tackled? Innovative medicine, clean sky, the sky ATM research, fuel cells and hydrogen. Most of these topics will be familiar to you, and there have been this more innovation and product-driven contractual PPPs, and there I highlight factories of the future because I will come to it, energy efficiency buildings, green cars, and future internet. All these PPPs have been very, very carefully analyzed by external evaluators. And here you see some numbers, and I do not want to put too much time on this one, but one of the biggest problems that we always have is that people are saying, oh, these programs are so awfully complicated. Yeah? For an SME, it's almost impossible to apply, and SMEs have almost no chance to get into successful consortia. And this was something that was supposed to be solved by this approach of the PPPs. And an amazing result is that the SME participation dramatically increased within the PPPs, and also the industrial participation within these programs dramatically increased. So when these project proposals were analyzed, it was a strong focus on having a very good equivalent of industry and research. So, for example, universities, research centers, that they have a proper balance. These projects should not be any more university driven. They should be industry driven, demand driven. So where the Commission put a target that they did not reach, yeah? So in the former FP7, they wanted to have SME participation 25%, but they didn't make it. They made around 17. In the public-private partnerships, they made 30%, for example, in the factories of the future. What they also analyzed is, of course, you know, which countries participated most, yeah? And this is just an overview. Okay, here we have Germany being the one that got the biggest amount of funding, yeah? And here you see the distribution within three different areas. So green cars, then the energy efficient buildings, and then factories of the future. And with these pictures, you see that different countries have a specific focus. So we know that Germany, for example, is very strong in this industry 4.0 approach. And you see also here that they have a massive contribution within the factories of the future. If you want to learn more, because I cannot give you all the backgrounds of this analysis, you can find all this in the internet. It's all published, where you can see the analyze of all the different PPPs. If you talk about the participation, and this is something we talked about in the introduction from the moderator, yeah, that we want to increase the participation of SMEs and also industry. And what you see here, the instrument works. It does the job. In PPPs, for example, if you talk about industry participation, you see that the amount increased to close to 30% in a PPP, whereas in FP7, it was just below 20. If you talk about the SMEs, we have also an increase here by close to 10%. And whereas other areas, for example, research centers and so on, they of course decrease in their participation. So for example, here you see the higher education. Yeah, it was very big in FP7, but it decreased. Of course, because the industry and SME was getting higher. Now, what is the change within the new research program, which is called the Horizon 2020? Within Horizon 2020, they continued some of those areas that I introduced before, but they also extended to new topics here. Bio-based industries, shift to rail, all the changes we saw also yesterday with the change in the railroad systems and so on. We have sustainable process industry, Spire, robotics, photonics, high performance computing, big data. And a continuation of the old ones, but with another focus. Now the focus is 5G in future internet. Green vehicles and so on is continued. And also the factories of the future. The amazing thing of these PPPs is that because these programs are really done together with the industry and it fits to the demand of the industry, we have a co-investment, yeah? So the amounts that are coming from private investment on top of the funding is 3 to 10 times higher. Yeah, and that shows the impact of these programs. The impact, I've listed here a lot of those impact numbers. If you just look if we tackle the factories of the future, manufacturing, it's 16% of Europe's GDP. It has been more. Yeah? 13 million jobs, twice as many in support activities such as logistics. 80% of the EU exports are manufactured goods. And this is, of course, if you see the political changes in some countries, like, for example, in UK, where they focused mainly on the service sector, yeah, and left out the manufacturing, that was a problem. It was not so much in UK with the unemployment rate, yeah, but also in Portugal, in Italy, in France, where they dramatically reduced the manufacturing and the support to manufacturing. There, unemployment rates are much higher than in countries that still tackle this topic. How does a contractual PPP work? It's a collaboration between industry and EU. They are equal partners in this program. They develop together in a partnership and they actively involve the advice from industry based on their demands. And then they start afterwards the road mapping, they open the calls, and this is in order to create as big impact as possible. If you want to have more info on this one, please check on the internet. When you put these highlights, like for example, Factories of the Future Impact Analyze, you find all these analyses described properly in the internet. And I think it's very good material for you to see and to align your instruments to those demonstrated here. Especially, we saw that yesterday, for example, energy efficient buildings, that was touched also by Professor Grün yesterday. The implementations. I will start with the future internet. If you see what's going on in the internet, you see that internet is, of course, an enabler. It enables industry to make new moves. Yesterday afternoon, in this later session, we saw very interesting presentations from SK Telecom and from the Ministry for Agra Sector and so on. And they have shown the impact of IoT in the agro sector. And the Internet of Things and also Internet by itself has a massive impact and is changing the game set in many, many classic and traditional sectors. This is the Internet of Things. The cloud environment, which is just like a highway, it's also an enabler. What is the future internet doing? In Europe, we have a small problem with entrepreneurship and having enough of entrepreneurship. We want to have much more SMEs, we want to have much more of those entrepreneurs that are really successful, those blockbusters. I think it's exactly the same like in Korea, yeah, where we need to boost that. And what are the right instruments to do that? And what do we need to do in order to support the SMEs? And here, within the future internet activities, the Commission did something quite amazing for me to make a big platform development, a service development, an enabler development, touch specific sectors, and then do a massive rollout where they give everything as open source free to the public in order to boost entrepreneurship. What they want to avoid is, of course, this vendor lock-in. The vendor lock-in is really a big problem for the web entrepreneurs all over the world. Whenever you think something is open source, you have to be very careful if it's really open source, or if there is somewhere a license behind it that will impact your business. And what the commission wanted to do is was standard southbound APIs, northbound APIs offered to applications, the APIs for the sensor providers, the portability across platform providers, all this has to be guaranteed, interoperability of the apps. And to have really a true innovation, and not only to work on a standard. This was done in the past. But the aim was here to generate non-intrusive, but it should coexist with city services, for example, when we talk about the open data portal where we collect, in the European open data portal, where we collect all the open data portal, open data that are coming from the governments and so on, and we want to make business out of it. How do we do that? And therefore, we have to have the instruments. And I will just run a bit out of time, so I will explain to you the different instruments and what the Commission has developed. So here you have a picture of what the Commission did. They took different sectors and developed an IT system under it. So you have in FIWARE, it is called FIWARE, you have generic enablers that are freely available. And then you have specific enablers that are, for example, for everyone who wants to do something in smart city apps or in smart agri-food apps. And this was a link I made yesterday to the afternoon presentation. Yeah? Or smart factory. Everything that is connected to smart factory, smart manufacturing, and so on. Whenever there is a developer that wants to do an app, they get a toolbox for free from the commission to be used to develop. So there have been different phases. There was a platform development. Then there were all the hackathons made, you know, in order to boost entrepreneurship. And now we are in this phase. We are here. And we as Intrasoft, we run at the moment 32 different startups that we take care for with a consortium of partners. And we give them all the infrastructure and we give them on top up to 150,000 euros and they should play with the instruments. And this creates already within our program, yes, 1,000 new startups. Important for you, this is an open system. It was made for Europe, but it's global. So we have already some of your countries you will see here. We have good agreements with some of these countries. If we come to Korea here, I talked yesterday to the guys from ST Telecom. Yeah, we have an agreement with South Korea, but not yet with the ministries. China, not yet there. Japan, not yet there. Please, if you are the right person, check these instruments and look how you could connect. And here is this invitation. Yeah, check on these links. It's FIWARE Mundus. You find it easily. And then you can start to talk and try to find a partner. Just a very small thing here on the smart manufacturing. Why is Europe boosting this smart manufacturing? Because Europe, you see some of these countries that are supposed to be good in manufacturing, they decreased their impact and their growth. And this had to be changed. So the instruments, if you see what is possible in manufacturing, something had to be changed. And no one knows, if you see the history of manufacturing, yeah, where we have been to massive mass production, we are now after the globalization impact, it goes in different areas. We have individualized products that need new instruments. We need to embed IoT completely within the manufacturing process in order to be successful. So, as I'm running out of time, I would like to invite you afterwards for a deeper discussion if you're interested. And I thank you very much for your participation in this section, and thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Broechler. We just listened to the views from the industries, especially through an example of European Union, especially in dealing with the competition from emerging economies and how to sort of maintain or promote the competitiveness of small and medium-sized industries. Now it's time to listen to the views from academia. We have a very multi-talented speaker today, and Dr. Mohammad Qayoumi, is that correct? Yeah. In fact, I've never seen this colorful resume he presented. He is multidisciplinary, and he has 4 or 5 degrees in nuclear engineering, electric engineering, and management accountancy. I don't know what he is, but he's also president of San Jose University. So he's a provost administrator. And importantly, he won, he was also inducted into the Silicon Valley Engineering Hall of Fame this year. So I think this explains what it is. Now, the Mohammed, the floor is yours. By the way, you have 10 minutes, huh?
Okay. Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be with all of you, and thanks for that introduction. It's an honor to be with all of you and really talk about a topic that is very near and dear to my heart, talking about fostering SMEs awareness, adoption, and exploitation and innovation. To give you an overview of what I'm going to be talking about in this short period of time. I messed up. Okay, let me try again. Okay. Yeah, basically in this short period, I would like to talk about how SMEs are the lifeblood of any economy, and every economy to improve, to continually thrive, it needs a large number of SMEs to come as part of the as part of its lifeblood, and also how the IT advances in the last decade or so has really helped us foster more opportunities for SMEs than we ever had in the past, and also an environment that how SMEs and MNCs can really collaborate and really live in an environment together, as well as also seeing that, you know, when we look at also all of the MNCs were at one time an SME, and seeing how we can, and then talk a little bit about the role of universities and how universities really play such an important role helping fostering innovation and be that lifelong flow of new SMEs, and then briefly talk about the experience of Silicon Valley. Well, first of all, as we talk about the new technologies, as our keynote speaker talked about, the advent of Internet of Things. We talk about cloud technologies, 3D printing, and all of these technologies have really brought new information, new environments that we didn't have in the past. You know, for instance, when we just talk about the Internet of Things, it's providing about a $19 trillion economic opportunity. Just for the public sector, we're talking about $4.6 trillion opportunity. So there's so much opportunity that I think it really provides, an exponential growth in all of these areas. As Ray Kurzweil mentioned, in the 21st century, the changes that we're going to see is going to be equivalent of what we have experienced in the past 20,000 years. So as part of it, everybody and every technology can literally is on an overdrive. The whole idea of big data, big data can bring so much new opportunities for us, in terms of $6 to $10 trillion globally. The social media and being able to extract a lot of information from unstructured data, the mobile and cloud computing, where even SMEs can have the type of tools and capabilities that was only limited to MNCs just a decade ago, and for prototyping, 3D printing, and everything provides so many other opportunities as well. I think as part of it, we have to look at so many other elements. One of them is the whole aspect of urbanization, the fact that a larger and larger part of the world population is living in large cities. And you know, just based on the McKinsey's report of last year, the top 600 cities of the world will basically have over 2 billion in population by 2025, but will have more than 60% of the world's economic capability. But as part of it, when we have that kind of a large concentration of people living in a small area, that really provides opportunities for clusters to develop, and that really is you know, where we see new ideas develop and far more information develop in a much quicker way. And one of the things that gives SMEs, in my view, a stronger competitive advantage is because SMEs can move much faster, be far more agile and more nimble compared to large organizations. Despite all of the large resources that large organizations have, one of the things that they have a difficulty, that is to be able to move as quickly as we can see moves in a small organization. So this whole idea of urban sector environments and that higher concentration of more technical people could really help us tremendously. And I think it's really provides this whole coupled with concept of clustering more opportunities than we've ever seen in the past. So in that kind of an environment, you know, what is really the role of universities? I think, and specifically when we talk about urban serving universities, I think urban serving universities have a very particular purpose in trying to be that, you know, first of all, trying to see how they can really build a human capital for the region, how they can help in enhancing economic vibrancy of the region, as well as building healthy and vibrant communities. Within that one, universities are the wetland or the sources of new innovative ideas. And those ideas in the, really become the forces and the basis of having new technologies. And that's where I think at the universities, teaching innovation and entrepreneurship is going to be one of the key key element. In the past, we all, you know, say, we used to say when in my age level, when we were going to college, the idea was go to college so you can land your dream job. In today's environment, the idea is go to college so you can invent your ideal job. And that basically is where I think universities, and especially urban universities, need to have a stronger link with industry so they'll be able to foster that type of an environment. So as part of it, what we really think students really learn. Traditionally, we have really talked about a T-shaped graduates. T-shaped graduates really meant that we want to make sure that students have some of the very basic skills that they need. These were fundamental skills. These constitute being able to communicate effectively regardless of what field they graduate, being able to think critically, be able to work in teams, have a strong ethical and civic compass, and think globally. And then the deeper and the narrow area was all of the technologies that they, all of the specific areas that they needed, whether it was in electrical engineering, whether it was material sciences, whether it was in biology, life sciences, or any other field. But I think what we need today is a third dimension, and that third dimension is technological fluency. So I think regardless of what area a student graduates, be that in English or engineering, be that in biology or history, they need a certain type of basic technological fluency to be successful and be able to provide such an environment for SME. So within that, you know, as far there are four key technologies that we expect every student to have some knowledge of, and that is nanotechnology, biotechnology, info technology, and cognitive technology, or NBIC. And that's basically one of the role of universities to make that sure that every student has some basic knowledge of these areas. The other part is how we can really provide opportunities for students so the learning can happen at different ways through the cloud system as well as face-to-face, as well as getting information from the industry, from public sector, from the national labs, as well as the courses that our professors develop, so we can really give the students the most comprehensive type of education that they really deserve and they really need in this current environment. Shift from that one for a couple of minutes, basically give you a sense of how, what has been really happening at Silicon Valley and why it has been a cradle of creativity and center of innovation. That basically is because of the fact that not only we have great universities and also we have a large number of large multinational corporations as well as a lot of SMEs, more than 35 to 40% of the venture capital in the US is invested in the Silicon Valley. And the reason for that is not only we have a lot of SMEs that are there, but we have major MNCs, basically 21 companies with a sale of over 5 billion, 34 with a sale of over 1 and over close to 100 between a sale of 150 to 92 billion dollars. And basically as part of that innovation, 1,000 innovation companies report really mentioned that in the Silicon Valley, the whole area of innovation is so much ingrained as part of the culture of organizations and that how organizations really look at and try to help all of their employees and students. Yeah, this is basically a sense of all of the universities at San Jose State, my former institution that I was the president there, as well as Berkeley, Stanford, and many other institutions. So you can see that whole ecosystem working with all of the industries together. That's what makes that successful. And lastly, basically, I will say this: the conclusion of comment from John Davy, which said every great advance in science has emerged from a new audacity of imagination. So I think for us to be able to move in that area of and fostering more SMEs and be able to work with MNCs, we need to have imagination because knowledge without imagination is not going to help us. Again, I appreciate your attention and thank you very much.
Thanks, Dr. Qayoumi. Now, having heard the views on the topic from the industry, program management, and academia, I think it's time to listen to the views from the entrepreneur himself. In fact, I'm really impressed with also the credentials of all speakers. And Dr. Naeem Zafar is a real entrepreneur. He started a new company, startup, at the age of 25. And he wrote 5 books on entrepreneurship. So that means he can just talk really with authority on this important issue and difficult issue of entrepreneurship. Naeem?
Okay, well, good to be here. And in addition to being a entrepreneur, I'm working on my 7th company right now in the IoT space. I've also been teaching at different universities for the last 10 years. Brown University in the East Coast, where I'm graduated from, and also University of California, Berkeley. So I wanted to share with you some thoughts about what small businesses, SMEs, can do differently. So let's even start by doing the definition. So I think we're in the wrong presentation right now. My premise of my talk is that let's even define what is a small or medium-sized enterprise. The definition in the United States is less than 50 employees is considered small, and less than 500 is a medium size. So the whole American economy is built on these small and medium-sized enterprises. There are 5.7 million SMEs in America. So this number is huge as compared to only 500,000, which is above that. My basic premise is, as an SME, you're screwed. You have no chance. The big guys have set up the rules according to what will favor them, and you'll be crushed. So it'll be very foolish or unwise for small and medium businesses to play by the same rules as set up by the large guys. You're just waiting for disaster. You have to think about doing it differently. You have to change something. You have to rewrite the rules if you have any chance to succeed. Let me take you back about 50 years. Go back to 1962. In the United States, there are large companies like Kmart, JCPenney, Sears, who dominate the supermarkets where people go to buy stuff. A small company is starting in Arkansas, in a small city in Arkansas. Out of frustration, then it takes about 4 hours every time you have to go shopping once a week. So this little company started with a different strategy. They said, we're going to offer brand name merchandise, but we're going to lower the pricing by getting rid of all the fancy stuff, the fancy stores, the customer service, lots of employees. We let the customer go pick up whatever they want and help themselves. They changed the rules how the game was being played. They further invested heavily in IT infrastructure, which gave them a superior edge. They can manage their inventory better than any of their competitors. And what happened? Today, Walmart has an annual revenue of $500 billion, $480 billion a year, employing 2.2 million employees. That strategy, because they played by the different rules, helped them get there. One of the strategies they use, they will only start in small cities with population of 5,000 or less. Because once you have a store in a small city, competitor does not want to enter because there's not enough people to support two stores. Let's take another example. PC business was a cutthroat, difficult, bloody business. How does a company went from starting in a college dorm, definitely a small enterprise, went on to become a $57 billion annual revenue company? Well, again, they changed the rules. While all other companies were selling through stores, when you can go and have a conversation and buy a laptop or a PC for yourself, they said, forget that. Because every 6 to 9 months, all the computer chip change and all the inventory you have is obsolete. We will only sell to businesses, we'll only sell direct, call us, or online. By doing that, they got rid of the problem of obsolete inventory, they got rid of the channel, and they became the most profitable number one laptop PC company in the 90s. How did these companies win? By changing the rules. Let me give you another example. Mobile phone industry in the United States is a crowded industry. In 2001, a new company wanted to start, enter the mobile space. That's a very crowded market. But what did they do? They said, well, why don't we go after the segments which is not being served well? Young people, age 15 to 24, people who do not have contracts. These people use telephones at a different time. Usually business people use during the daytime. These students and young professionals often talk to each other in the evening. So they cannot have to burden the same network. They actually rented the network from Sprint, and they also went after a new way by making it a prepaid phone service. Instead of having a contract, you fill up your phone for $10 and $20. When you run out, you run out. They rewrote the cost equation by eliminating bills you have to print and mail. You got rid of the credit checks because there is no credit. The way it was sold, they start selling them into retail store in a clamshell packaging. They restructured the business model so they can make money where AT&T and Verizon could not. And to make it more appealing, they made it cool. They made it cool by doing a partnership with MTV. When you can watch your own favorite playlist on your phone, you can share with other people, you have celebrities from MTV promoting it. This is how you do it. Let me give you one more example. Music business is not a good business to make money if you're a musician. For every CD sold for like $20, the musician gets like $1. And if you have six people in the band, you're all getting a few pennies. This band, Grateful Dead, started in San Francisco Bay Area. They had another idea. They never were going to have a lot of number one hits. They were no Mariah Carey. So how do they make money? What they realized, why don't we make the music free? And we make all our money by selling concert tickets and merchandise. They even opened their digital setup, you can come in, plug in your own tape recorder, and you can download free digital quality music and share it with your friends. So totally bypassing the established rules, this became one of the most profitable band in the history, only after Rolling Stones. Why I'm giving you these examples? All these examples are meant to indicate for an SME to succeed, you have to change the rules. You have to change the rules. I know these big businesses look insurmountable. They look like so tough, there is no way to kill them. But every monster has an underbelly. There's an underbelly of the beast. This is where you have to attack. For the rhinoceros, it's right between his armpit. That's where you can hit the rhinoceros, the skin is weak. Just like Virgin Mobile hit AT&T and Verizon when they were weak, which is a segment of the population who was not signing up contract, was not spending $100 a month. By doing that, they not only got that segment, but they also got other segments of visitors. They got the segment of old people who wanted occasional use, have a backup phone for emergencies. So unless you are rethinking that how to attack the established players, you're screwed. And this is my whole point, that small and business enterprise have to understand what the rules of the games are and then figure out which rules are they going to change. I live and work in Silicon Valley for the last 30 years. I've been teaching about entrepreneurship and innovation for the last 10 years in the university. This is the method we always use. The method is to find what is the weakness of the competitor and how could we exploit it. No one company can do everything well. There's always a weakness. Even big giant company, I can give you many examples. Intel perhaps had the strongest R&D budget of any chip company in the world, any semiconductor company. But what did ARM do? ARM found a way that for low cost, low power processor, which is used in every mobile phone, they became the choice because Intel was weak there. Intel keeps thinking for their Pentium style chips. Take the example of Google. Google is one of the strongest company with the most profitable, unlimited amount of R&D, 60,000 employees. Best idea they have for social was Google Plus. Like, that's a disaster. They couldn't do what Facebook did. So every company has a DNA, every company has a strength, but every company also has a weakness. SME's job is to identify and exploit that weakness. That's where the innovation comes in, is exploiting the weakness in the battlefield. And companies who understand this will do very well as they move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Zafar. You know, Naeem is saying that even though SMEs have some technological strength and merits to exploit, but they are subject to the vulnerability, you know, coming from the industrial structure. So what he's saying is you have to change the rules, and good entrepreneurs should be able to change the rules to have a strategy to create strategic advantages. Now, we have another speaker from the research institute establishment. Dr. Toshihiko Kanayama is from the National Institute of Advanced Industrial Science and Technology in Tsukuba, Japan, which is the cluster, the most well-known cluster, industrial cluster in Japan. Now he is saying that, wait a minute, even if SMEs have the strategic sort of advantages, that is not enough. Now he's saying that they actually lack in capabilities, technology capabilities and resources, and they don't have a capacity, usually the capacity to link the technological findings to the industrial commercial strength. So what the research institutes have to do? I think this is the topic. Thank you. Dr. Kanayama.
Well, thanks for the introduction. Oh, it's my great pleasure and honor to be here to present what our institute is increasing our effort towards the promotion of SMEs. I mean that the major mission of our institute is to do research by ourselves. But at the same time, our mission is to create innovations in the country and globally. That's why we are forming a platform on which everyone can utilize our expertise and our equipment and our facilities to make innovations. That's what I will introduce you at the moment. And but why we are fostering the SME and the startups? As previous speaker said, that the one SME cannot compete with large companies as a whole. But in terms of disruptive innovations, that is not true, because SME or startups should have very clear entrepreneurship, and also they should have a unique business model to compete with the large companies. But instead, the SMEs and the startups do not have enough capabilities and also funding, neither human resources. That's why we are preparing the platforms to provide them with necessary resources. There is another important factor, that is that in particularly in Japan, SMEs are major contributors to the local regional economies. And because that mainly the big companies and particularly the MNCs are mainly located in the big cities such as in Tokyo and Osaka, but the small companies are distributed in all over the countries. So let me take this opportunity to say a few words concerning our AIST. And we are the National Public Institute belonging to our government, and we have a total number of employees around almost 500. And we are covering almost entire range of industrial technology, starting from the energy environment and IT and human factors, electronics, manufacturing, life science, materials chemistry, and also we are keeping national standard for metrology in our country. And also we are geological survey of Japan. And we have 10 sites distributed all over the country, and headquarters are located in the Tsukuba Science City. And that's why we are utilizing our local branches to form a local ecosystem to foster the local SMEs and also startups. But the number of 500 employees and 2,000 permanent researchers are not enough to deal with everything. So recently, we are increasing our relations with the local public research organization, which is operated by the local government. And I was talking about how to create the ecosystem. And our role is to create a kind of platform on which the SMEs can participate in to develop their own business model and entrepreneurships. As I said before, they are lacking in technology and also the human resources. And also, they need some equipment and facilities to verify their own technological ideas. And also, they need some large-scale facility to the purpose of prototyping productions. And at the same time, usually SMEs or startups are lacking in the connections to create the value chains. So this also we are providing on top of our innovation platform. And we are creating these kind of platform all over the 10th site of our institute. The major one is located in Tsukuba, under the name of Tsukuba Innovation Arena for Nanotechnology. This is a joint effort, not only by us, but also other members of a research institute located in Tsukuba. And we selected nanotechnology because this has a very wide impact on a wide area of industrial technologies. And another one is by an IT fusion research base, located in Tokyo area, Bay Area. And also, recently, we organized a new institute in Fukushima area, which is devoted to the renewable energy research. And you know, probably many of you know this name, Fukushima. Fukushima is met a kind of a disaster arising from the accident in nuclear power plant in a, according to a heavy head earthquake. And in order to reorganize the, every industry in Fukushima, we decided to create a new organization devoted to the Renewable Energy Institute. And this institute is covering almost entire area of renewable energy, starting from solar power and wind power and energy storage and geothermal. And the mission of this institute is not only to become a world global hub for renewable energy, but it, this institute solicits local regional SMEs to participate in the development of renewable energy. An example is that the pillar of this wind power generation is constructed by a local, very small constructive company located in Fukushima. And also we are making some kind of a consortium on which the, every company can deal with the development of new renewable energy research. And another thing is that how to provide them with sufficient equipment and technological ideas. And we provide them with the research equipment and facility not only for the research purpose, but also for the production purpose for a small scale. And this is one example. Hokkaido site of AIST is working on to be a platform for the closed type plant factory. And by utilizing this factory and the original idea invented in the AIST, that is some genetically notification of strawberry by using this closed factory, then a company, a small company, has succeeded in the commercialization of new drug for dog disease. This is one example. And another factor is that human resources. And we are devoting our effort for developing many kind of technological expertise and for the SMEs and also for the university people. And one particular system we have just started is that the Nanotech Career Alliance under the name of Nanotech Cubal. And this is also a joint effort, not only by us, but also other institute located in Tsukuba. Also, we have a counterpart in Kyoto area, which is located in the western part of our country. So the mission of this one is to cover the entire area of Japan, and also we open our gate to the global networking system to accept the trainees to participate in some kind of courses provided by us. And we are also doing some effort towards promotion of startups. And this is one particular example. And we are forming a kind of task force system to promote new ideas coming from the researchers, not only limited in researchers employed in AIST, but from outside. And but usually, to create a company requires some additional knowledge, such as a business persons, in addition to the technological person. So we search for the suitable persons who have some experience for the business, and they form a joint team, I mean a task force, in 2 years, and we support them with some financial support to be a startup. And during this course, already 49 companies have succeeded in to be a startups, and 7 of them have succeeded in some M&A or IPO to reach some exit. So what is important for us is to how to make some connection network between us and the SMEs, particularly for the local, regional SMEs and the startups. For this purpose, we are forming a kind of a consortium under the name of Tech Bridge Club, And already we have more than 150 member companies now joining in this membership. And we can supply them with some consulting and collaboration and also some joint application to the, some competition type of funding. And recently we are increasing our relation with financial organization, particularly for the local bank and the VCs. And they have enough money, but they do not have technological knowledge or expertise. That's why they need our support to evaluation and selection of the suitable SMEs. And also, we are collaborating with the local government. And as I said before, the role of a local public institute is indispensable. So I was talking about how to promote the SMEs and startups. But nowadays, you know, the technological advancement is so rapid and diversified, so does as the societal demands. So to conclude, no biggest company can compete with the everything by themselves to cause the disruptive innovations. And if the platform, this kind of platform, is well organized and efficiently used, then that the SME can do as well. So this is the conclusion of my talk. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thanks, Kanayama-san. Now we just heard the voices from various stakeholders, and I'm sure that there is no doubt that the role of government is important in the ecosystem in order to foster, in order to maintain a healthy ecosystem. We need to have a good, well-functioning, and well-conceived government at both national and local levels. Now we have a speaker from the local government who got her hands wet for a long time in Brisbane. So we will have Ms. Matson from Australia, from Brisbane City Council. Thank you, Kat.
Thank you. Distinguished guests and colleagues, both on and off the stage, thank you for having me here today. I have the extraordinary pleasure of being the Chief Digital Officer for a city, for the city of Brisbane, in fact. Now, New York City was the first city in the world to appoint a Chief Digital Officer. Brisbane happened to be the second, and I happen to be that city's second Chief Digital Officer. Now, it's a title that is still gaining traction in the commercial world, let alone in the city world, but for us in our city, what it means is driving economic development through the adoption and the city's transformation into that digitally enabled economy, ensuring that we remain connected to the rest of the world as our economy becomes increasingly globalized through digital. Our gorgeous city has a population of only 2.2 million people, considerably smaller than some of the counterparts that we're presenting here with today. And just to give you some context on that, that 2.2 million people live collectively in a space of about 16,000 square kilometres, or approximately 6,000 square miles. The small businesses of our community employ approximately 40% of our population. So small businesses and ensuring small businesses' survival is extraordinarily important to us as a city. So one of the things that we focus on in terms of encouraging our small businesses to stay connected with innovation, with the new digitally enabled economy, is how to build their capability. We know that the barriers to innovation and the barriers often to success as well for small businesses are availability to money and their own profitability. It's the lack of time. Small business owners fill a number of roles within their businesses and they do not have the time to do the research and development and invest in innovation. There's also significant fear and risk aversion in our small businesses. Because their profit lines are so vulnerable to changes, they're often averse to trying out new things. The first area that we focus on is building digital capability. ensuring that our small businesses understand where digital fits in their business models, and helping them to understand that it's not just about trying to keep up with every new innovation or every new social media platform, but understanding where it fits in their business model. We do this through education workshops, but most importantly through telling stories of other businesses who have used digital in their businesses. For example, one of the most popular videos we have on our website is about a fruit and vegetable store run by a family who have used digital platforms to improve their profitability through selling online but also managing their inventory. We also need to build capability when it comes to disruption and helping our small business owners understand where the disruptive threats may come from in their industry and helping them to not be so fearful of it. Companies like Uber, like Airbnb, have forever changed some industries, and what we do with our small business owners is help them understand where are the areas ripe for disruption in their industries. How we do that is by showcasing the fact that supply chains have shrunk. We no longer have as many intermediaries, and in fact, platforms like social media have forever changed the way that customers expect to connect with their businesses or with the brands that they connect with. And so if our small businesses can understand those shortened supply chains and reach out direct to their customers, they also have a better chance of understanding what it is that their customers want and perhaps finding that disruption opportunity. Another area where we help our small business owners build capability is in understanding business models and understanding where in their business model they might be able to improve. One of my personal favourites is the business model canvas, because by breaking down a business model onto one page and having a look at all of the different building blocks, we're able to showcase to our small business owners where, which building block could they innovate in and therefore improve profitability, reach new markets, or perhaps create new products or services. The final element of the capability building piece for our small businesses is awareness. Purely and simply awareness of the opportunities that are going on around them. The opportunities that small businesses do employ 40% of our population and the awareness that we are supporting. The other key element for innovation in our small business sector is building connectivity. The first way that we build connectivity is by actually opening up the markets between small businesses and government. In the past, in the olden days, as I like to say, small businesses would basically pull down or would acquire from government, but it was very difficult for them to sell back to government. But of course, government at all levels, and in Australia we have local, state and federal governments, government at all levels can be a significant customer for small businesses, particularly those who are developing new technologies. So one of the things that we're actually doing is changing our procurement systems to enable small businesses to reach out to government organisations and to government departments and potentially sell a new innovation. And in fact, Brisbane City Council has just launched its innovation proposals policy, which opens up the opportunity for small businesses to submit unsolicited proposals to council to solve everyday civic problems that we currently don't have a solution to. Another key area of connectivity that we're building in Brisbane is around the wider ecosystem. In the past, innovation we assumed came from the corporates, from government, sometimes, and from the larger institutions. In recent times, though, we see a lot of the innovation come from startups, from the innovation hubs, from small businesses even. And what we're doing is actually showcasing that once again those supply chains and those collaboration chains are no longer linear. They are in fact a web, a collaborative web. So we are consistently looking for new opportunities to connect all different members of the ecosystem together. Whether it's bringing them together in innovation hubs, whether it's providing networking opportunities, or whether it's opportunities like these where we literally bring all members of the ecosystem in together to talk about how they can play together. Connectivity needs to be outside of Brisbane as well. We're a small town, a long way away from the rest of the world a lot of the time. And so one of the things that we are doing very proactively is building our relationships with cities around the world, particularly our sister cities like Daejeon, but also other cities that are facing similar challenges in similar ways and who are already ahead of the game when it comes to their innovation building capabilities. For example, Auckland, just over the ditch in New Zealand, are doing some fantastic stuff in the innovation space. And so we are establishing entrepreneurial city partnerships where we actually share ideas, but also provide safe landing places for our small businesses and for our entrepreneurs who want to visit new markets and have access to new markets. So it's through building capability and building connectivity, both within our ecosystem as well as to the wider global ecosystem. They're the two key ways that we're encouraging our small businesses to foster and to adopt and even innovate themselves. Thank you.
All SMEs, I think, start from somewhere. And even big corporations, multinational corporations, Apple, Samsung, had to start from somewhere. I think they start as a venture and go through a life cycle to become a larger company, medium-sized company, and go through the phases of development. I think from the start, when the new technologies are discovered or new IPRs are created, now the many entrepreneurs may face also difficulties on the difficult issue of commercialization, or how to convert the technologies into the products that can be sold to the market. Among my compatriot Koreans, I haven't seen not so many who have done this job, but we have today two of my compatriots who have done this job, and I don't know whether they are the brothers or relatives, they have the same surname. Mr. Inje Cho was a law major. It's very rare for a law major to be in this position, and apparently he's a specialist in IPR. And Mr. Hoonje Cho is a COO of MakersVill company, which is also, I think, the venture incubator company. So we'll just listen to how they just incubate small ventures, taking advantage of newly discovered technologies, or for small and medium-sized companies that want to just maintain the technological edges. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to Daejeon, Korea. It is a well-known fact that venture companies contributed to the Korea industry more than top 30 conglomerates with respect to employment since the 1997 IMF crisis of Korea. Conglomerates have hired local employees from China or Vietnam as they moved their factories to Southeast Asia in order to reduce production costs. On the contrary, venture companies hired domestic workers and thus created new jobs at home. Such phenomena is not novel in countries with high GDP per capita, such as the USA and Japan. Developing countries will eventually have to face the same problem in the future. From early on, the Korean government acknowledged the facilitating startups could stimulate domestic economy and create new jobs. However, the outcome was not satisfactory compared to the amount of finances and support the government invested in startups. As a result, the government began to examine each paid from founding a high-tech startup company to successfully reaching a sustainable state as the following. As an entrepreneur with a high-tech skilled established company with a 50,000 to 100,000 US dollar fund, this fund will be most depleted in early stage setup, which takes about 6 months to a year. Most startups try to recruit people from early on, but they often waste their time without much fruit. Based on the company's need, founders will raise an additional 50,000 to 100 US dollar fund to commercialize their technology. Companies soon realize that commercialization costs more than they have expected, so they raise an extra 50,000 to 100,000 US dollar fund. But they suffer from financial lag. For a startup with multiple co-founders, founders often bicker over new product development and business administration in this stage. B, pilot or beta burden production for commercialization requires a greater amount of money within a short period of time. On average, it required 200,000 or 300,000 US dollar fund, but the company may not have any dispensable money after stages A to C. As a result, stage D often takes 2 to 3 years, when it should be completed within 6 months. If commercialization is delayed, the final product may become unattractive to the customers. After pilot or beta version production, mass production based on market evaluation, as well as publicizing and the marketing activity should follow. In this period, 1 or 2 years of stable production and the marketing activities should go together, which cost about 500,000 to 3 million US dollar. If it is a software development business, it costs 500,000 to 1 million US dollar. If hardware development business, then 2 million to 3 million US dollar. Of course, it is another issue whether customers would actually purchase the product after manufacturing and the marketing plans are executed. If the product is successful in the market, then the company has to decide how much more to produce. When the company had a hardware business, additional land, factories, employees, and the fund should all come smoothly. Many venture companies lose its vitality after facing cold response from the market in this stage. Unfortunately, they often decide to become subcontractors to conglomerates to have a more stable business. Companies should constantly try to improve their design and skills, as well as to lower the price, as the customers are easily changing their products. Stages C and D, as shown above, are called to Death Valley, where most startups are overturned due to lack of funding. Even companies with a robust finances get through stages C, but they rarely manage to pass the deepest valley of death, stage B, or the next stage E. Dr. Hoonje,
moderator, I need 7 minutes about. Excuse. Hello, I'm a younger brother of a twin with Inje Cho. And now I will introduce TIPS and TIPS Town. The Korean government recognized that direct support for startup was inefficient. The optimal way for the government to help nurture them was to select the private accelerators, co-invest in startups, and to offer a variety of a mentoring program until startups commercialize their technology and grow as viable enterprises in the market. This is a tech incubator program for startups. Now, I will mention tips again and again, and SBMA is a government bureau, small and medium business administration, meaning. Ever since 2012, when five tips operators were selected by the government, and four to five operators kept being added every year. As of September 24, 2015, the total number of TIPS operators is 18. Since early 2015, 3 years after the introduction of TIPS, high-tech startup entrepreneurs began to recognize TIPS is a very key stepping stone for establishing a successful venture company. Venture capitals began to invest in startups that have gone through TIPS because they consider them to have a high chance of success. Accelerators provide indispensable support for their success. Accelerators not only give guidance on administration and management support, technical support, and a second funding, manufacturing support. These are the criteria of achievement of TIPS passing companies. One, successful M&A. Two, being listed on the stock market. Three, about $600,000 annual revenue. Four, attain about $2 million US VC sequential investment. As the number of TIPS accelerator increases, the number of TIPS startup companies increases, and 18 accelerators selected 45 startup companies during the first 9 months of 2015. As of now, the total number of TIPS passing startups, 108 companies. Now, I will introduce the TIPS Town. TIPS Town has a considerable location where venture founders can easily meet up and exchange ideas and freely communicate, and where young people prepare together. After listening to a variety of venture-based people, SMBA concluded that the best location is where venture employees most prefer. Since the real estate price has gone up very high, most of the successful venture companies have moved out of Tehran Berkeley and to outside to Seoul. However, those venture companies have complained about the following problem. One, it is hard to exchange information with other ventures. Two, it is difficult to receiving funding. And three, it is hard to recruit young employees. Tipsound is just 10 minutes from Yeoksam Station. Tipstown is consists of five buildings. The rest stop of intercity bus is located about 500 million away from Gangnam Station through subway line number 2 and intercity bus stop half of the Korean population, 25 million people, can access TIPS-TOWN. TIPS-TOWN started with these five buildings here, and we're keeping expanding along this four lane roads. I think someday, once TIPS-TOWN grows into 50 to 100 buildings along this street, I believe TIPS-TOWN will evolve into a great venture hub, just like Silicon Valley and Tech City in London. Now, I will introduce MakersVill. This is a view from the main building in TIPS-TOWN. MakersVill is on the first floor of this main building. We are open 365 days a year, every day for average 20 hours. People come make mock-up and run hardware and software education. And primary to secondary school students are running here as well. During the weekdays, talks and different programs are offered for benchers and start of almost every day. MakersVill can teach up to 300 to 400 people at once using these broadcasting facilities. In addition, all of these education programs, lectures, and teaching materials can be distributed online right at the time when these events are taking place. We can provide a live streaming video all around the world where 10 billion people can access the video at the same time. We have a total of 24 3D printers for educational purpose. We use them for mock-up. We will purchase an extra 100 printers next year so we can educate 400 to 500 people at the same time. These are the 3D printers for industrial use. I'm sorry. One is 3D printer for plastic materials, and the other is a plaster printer. By the end of a new year, we will have a four more 3D printers for industrial use. And at the end of this year, we will have metal 3D printers ready. Are you looking for a product that will turn up your vehicle? We can make it with our metal 3D printer. Of course, we will be charging you for matters and a little bit of operation fees. Now, conclusion. Within 3 years since 2012, TIPS has been considered the best program to boost the startup across the barrier of death and lead to success. More than 100 startups have received more than $50 million investment and are receiving support for technology, administration, production, and overseas expansion. The Korean government is still constructing the TIPS-TOWN to facilitate the startup and to promote the Make a Culture movement. SMBA and ActernerLAB has founded the prototype workshop MakersVill to maximize the function of TIPS-TOWN as a whole. Thank you for your attention.
As you heard, the Korean government is probably one of the most advanced, or maybe not advanced, actually, one of the governments that adopt the most proactive, even interventionist program to accelerate the venture development process. Of course, there are pros and cons discussed in the market. And the con side, they talk about the bureaucratization of the program and procedure-driven programs that could nurture also corruptive practices and that could nurture also the technologies that cannot be sold in the market. But the pros frequently mentioned in the form of acceleration or maybe expedited process to foster the development of ventures. Well, we just heard the diverse views from very diverse speakers. And the promoting the SMEs and also promoting the SMEs to maintain the momentum to stay on the edge, technological edges, is not an easy task that encompasses so many difficult topics. I wonder whether there is any critical path to it, or maybe there may be any sort of important a la carte of critical sort of factors that could be conducive to the expedited promotion of SMEs. Maybe I will just give one more maybe opportunity to our speakers to express views on this topic if they have additional sort of views, and then I will just open the floor from the audience. And who will? Okay, thank you.
Okay, if I'm having difficulty turning on this mic. Well, I think your point is well taken. I mean, that's where I think the education system comes to be a critical role, to see how we can really foster that whole aspect of innovation and entrepreneurship from the in our educational system. So that's how that really becomes part of the culture, that becomes part of the DNA of every one of our students, and then seeing how we can really make our processes, all of our rules and regulations, so we can make the entry of new ideas much easier to come to the market. I think if you're able to do that one, that's how we can really foster a stronger environment. And because of the fact that today's technology allows us to be global, even as a small company, seeing those capabilities plus that kind of a culture and that kind of a, fostering that type of an environment, I think we can have SMEs flourish and new ones come. So that's why, as I said in my presentation, that I really look at universities to be the wetland of new ideas and new entrepreneurship. So knowledge plus imagination is what really will give us opportunity to continually bring new companies to the market. And as Professor Zafar mentioned, trying to find out the weaknesses of the large organizations, and through that, how we can really progress and foster in the future.
Thanks, Mohammed. And also, today we have two speakers who mentioned some sort of PPP. And Raimund mentioned and explained how the European Unions will go with this concept of PPP. And my compatriots introduced a much stronger of PPP with government acceleration and intervention. Perhaps it's time to listen to Raymond's view on this form of PPP.
Yeah, I think what is interesting is in the PPP is that they in the future internet that they incorporated the entrepreneurship support within a PPP. So as I was maybe a bit short, but there were three phases within this program where they built up the infrastructure, they evaluated the system, and they built all the enablers, and then the phase three was this massive rollout. But the rollout was not targeting the existing network, it was an entrepreneurship program. And within this entrepreneurship program, they developed acceleration funding support, so up to 150,000 euros, plus on top the acceleration services. And I think this is very, very comparable to the Korean approach, yeah, where you have the acceleration program plus some funding, seed funding, and then also to take care at the end of the program to have follow-up financing. For the European Commission, this was definitely absolutely new approach, but I think it really works. We have already 1,000 new startups within this program, which is, if you see the amount of money spent, quite reasonable.
Yeah. Thanks. Yes.
So I have to disagree. I think if you look at governments are not good at starting companies. Governments are good at starting wars. You know, go collect taxes, fight a war someplace. From all the great companies which have changed the way we live, have started by people who were passionate, who were misfits of society, who could not be controlled or tamed, and they created something which is amazing. So this idea of a government setting up a factory or a PPP, and somehow you can start companies, yeah, 1,000 companies are started. How many have changed the world or are likely to do it? I'll be skeptical till I see the results. If you look at the most successful incubators or accelerators in the world, Y Combinator, Techstar, StartX, none of them had any government involvement. So I caution you to see, understand the underlying, what makes companies start and go someplace is this almost crazy, irrational passion, which very seldom comes from the governments.
I have a warning signal against my sort of lack of time management skills. So we have passed the time. And maybe we just open the floor to the audience. And if you have questions, maybe we just have one or two questions from the floor. If you don't have any questions from the floor, I think it's time to maybe close this session. And this is really the important and difficult topic. I visited many countries and advised other governments, and all of the governments actually are interested in this topic and do not have solutions, do not have the wise solutions. And the Raimund mentioned the smart manufacturing, and the solution should be smart and with sufficient regard to local conditions and the industrial situation they are in. So I think by having this sort of session, we could be sufficiently educated on the topic to prepare ourselves for our jobs in dealing with policy formulation, elaboration, undertaking our jobs as researchers, and so on and so forth. So thank you very much. And why don't you just give also applause to our distinguished speakers. And thanks for being a good audience too. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your active participation. Let's wrap up the session, and please give a big round of applause to all speakers again.
여러분들의 열정적인 참여로 유익한 토론회장이 이루어질 수 있었습니다. 감사합니다.